Good evening. The American writer Hunter S. Thompson has this great line about how if you stand on a hilltop outside Las Vegas and look west, you can see the very point at which the tide of the 60s finally stopped and began to ebb backwards. If you stand on this hill outside Runcorn and look north, you can see the very point at which the thrill and the vigor of late 80s British youth culture reached its high watermark before ebbing backwards into the flotsam of Britpop and fizzy pop. You can see Spike Island Witness, and the man who held center stage at the concert that was Spike Island was the legendary Ian Brown.
I shouldn't be here, you know. If he was in a group in 66 and you were known, he wouldn't have been there in 78, 79. If he was known in 77, you shouldn't be there in 1990. You know, my first LP was 12 years ago, I shouldn't be here. Pop music is supposed to have a short lifespan. I'm not one of those big artists like Bowie. I shouldn't be here, but I am. I'm standing in the shadow of the
sea. Ian's still part of the whole system. And always will be, as far as I'm concerned.
He's the face that's launched a thousand haircuts.
Ian has got the genuine, definitive Manchester swagger.
He is everything a star should be.
He can't sing rock, but he can present something that I think's better on a higher level.
Is he not a loose cannon?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely, but that's what makes him interesting.
The musical autumn of 2001 will be enriched by the release of the third album in the solo career of former Stone Roses lead singer Ian Brown.
It's bedroom music, it's personal music, is that correct?
It's expensive bedroom music. It was made in an house in Shepherd's Bush, the kid I co-wrote it with. He had his wife and his child in the back bedroom, and we took over the front room. We had £400,000 worth of equipment in the front room. We borrowed all the equipment, and we spent the whole winter working in the house, not with a view to where we were going to take it, just to get the songs down. We wanted to use proper songs, but the main thing is I wanted to have the most modern sound we could get, super modern 2001 sound. And to complete that, we had to go into a proper studio to mix it.
It's all about songs, though, isn't it? Fear, is it? Is that, Fear. That's the lead single, is it?
Yeah, first single, yeah.
What are you prepared to do to make it a hit?
I'll only do what I feel comfortable in doing. Like, I did an interview recently with Q magazine, and they suggested that I take my picture halfway up this old 2,000-year-old tree. Which I saw the tree, it's a big, wide, beautiful tree, and I thought, why not? When I get the article, they've got me half up a tree and the headline's barking. For each of all,
have you consciously placed your voice somewhere in the mix?
Yeah, I've got it, so it's as strong as it can be without it drowning the music out. Forget
everything and remember. Your voice sounds really good on this, on the new album, but you still have, there's some very Mancunian twang in it.
Sometimes I lay it back and I think, boy, it sounds really northern, that. Let me do it again. And the guys are going, no, that is you. Leave it. You know, my mother said, when you're doing this program, can you talk properly, because your accent's sometimes too strong for me to pick up, so...
In terms of myths and stuff, there is this idea that you're brilliant, you're fantastic, but maybe your voice isn't that good.
Yeah.
Where does this come from? Because the voice sounds great on the new album.
I have done a few bad shows, but I did used to play with a guitarist that had four Marshall amps, or four Fender twin hot-wired amps. So I sometimes couldn't hear myself singing. So maybe I'd shout, so that sounds shit straight away. And I did do Reading in 96, and the singing was awful. But when I first come out, they said he sings like an angel, he sings like a eunuch.
Right on, man. Right on.
Don't you
get you, pam, pam, pam. It's cool, like, yeah.
Are you okay, Alan?
Influences make musicians what they are. What made Ian Brown?
How important were the Pistols to you?
When you're 14, the Pistols are everything. They're saying everything how it is. Plus you had the Jubilee year, and you can see everything when you're 14. When you're 14, you're wide awake. You know exactly what's going on, and the Pistols were perfect for us. And they were only 19, I think, at the time.
They were young.
Yeah.
What made you a musician?
I'm in Hume, it's 1983, and the girls just had a party. She's 21, and a kid called Glenn. You remember Glenn that used to work in New Order?
Yeah.
He brought Gino down to the party because he was working at Salford Tech.
Gino Washington, the great...
Gino Washington, yeah. He brought him down, this guy, to the party. He just played Salford Tech. And during the party, Gino keeps telling me, I'm a star. You're a star, you're a star, you're a star. You should be a singer, you're a star. I'm like, what's up with this old guy? Like, you know, he's on my case. He just kept saying it to me all night, be a singer. He kept saying, be a singer, go for it, be a singer.
Because actually, your main activity then was scootering, wasn't it?
Well, I was mainly into martial arts. From age 11 till 18, I did martial arts every day, 7 days a week. But we used to make our own scooters, yeah, choppers. We weren't mods, but we used to go to the Northern Soul all-nighters. We used to make our own choppers and bone-down scooters. Used to go all over, yeah. That would be 80, 81, 82.
Cut-down scooters and martial arts.
Bruce Lee was my hero. When I was a kid, I didn't have music posts. I had Bruce Lee all over my room. My dad took me to see Way of the Dragon when I was 14, and it was supported by Naked Over the Fence with Sylvia Crystal. So I kind of sat in my dad's like, phew.
The influences fermented. Gino Washington's advice was taken, and the Stone Roses were formed. Now it's 1988. The Stone Roses is controversially graffitied all over Manchester. And I've got my own TV show in this studio, The Other Side of Midnight. And guess what? I'm not having the Roses on. I'd seen them in 85 when they were a bunch of goths, and now they're being managed by a bunch of my ex-partners. No way. Until Gary Whelan, drummer of the Happy Mondays, plays me anonymously a song. It's utterly wonderful, and it's by the Stone Roses, and all I can say is, I'm sorry. 89 begins then with a complete admission of error on my part. Big apologies, and here's a new one from the excellent Stone Roses. How did you feel about doing The Other Side of Midnight?
We were made up to do The Other Side of Midnight.
Were you?
Yeah, made up, absolutely made up.
Didn't look like it, because you always... You do seem to be moody, brothers.
Yeah, I think we was pretty moody that day. I think we were nervous.
Oh.
Yeah.
It was good, though. In fact, it was more than good. What's your memories of it?
Yeah, it sounded good. Crescent looked good.
Yes?
Yeah, sounded good. It's the first time we've been in one of the proper studios where it's all white.
A cyclorama, even.
Right.
The very cyclorama. And one important point about Madchester and Acid House. Manny the bass player and Cressa the roadie, they were acid, but the Roses themselves were always rock. Great rock.
Well, the Roses, no, they didn't sound like Manchester because they weren't a dance band, basically. And we thought we were beyond rock. We didn't realise it was going to come hurtling back around the other side.
I think, without any doubt, the Stone Roses are the most important British band of the last 2-3 decades, without any doubt.
Why didn't they take over America? Yeah. Geffen, the big company, had paid all that money and it was all blah, blah, blah.
Why haven't hardly any bands taken over America for about the last...
15 years.
And I'll tell you the reason is because of the way the industry is, it's very media-driven and you can become a star in 5 minutes in... Certainly in England, and if you're lucky, also in Europe. And that doesn't happen in America.
What went wrong for the Roses? Drugs and children is the oft-quoted explanation. It wasn't that they were doing drugs, They were doing different drugs. They'd had a flamboyant, crazy but effective manager, and they got rid of him.
There's four little chiefs.
Always the worst mistake.
With a $2 million advance. But I like the David Geffen. We met David Geffen and he basically said, your music, you can do anything you want. I don't care, we can sell anything. But give me three great videos. That's how you become a star in America. Give me three great videos, you'll go. Musically, you can do whatever you want. And I thought, for a billionaire, he had a brilliant attitude.
Yeah. Did you ever give him any videos?
Yeah, but they weren't three great videos. There was no one to give us that kick up the arse that we needed at that time.
I suppose you ever gave the money back to David Geffen, did you?
No, well spent, gone, all given away, yeah.
The Roses disbanded, the dream was over. What was Ian going to do?
Did you think, or did you always know there'd be a solo career?
No, I didn't at that time then. I thought, I'll start collecting the Roses bootlegs and I'll sell them.
You actually thought that was going to be your life?
Yeah. I thought, I don't want to form another band because I'll never get another band as good as this. And I'm not strong enough to be solo. I don't want to be a pop star.
The more obvious course was for Ian Brown to fade away, to be honest.
I think probably people did think that they'd seen the last of Ian Brown in terms of music, because you heard these gardening rumours, and you heard these rumours that, you know, he was moving to South America and didn't want anything to do with it anymore, he'd given his money away to people in the street, all of which were believable about Ian Brown.
The end of Ian Brown? No, the end of part one.
He's got a lot of integrity, and his integrity is that he knows he knows you have to work for a living. And he's also a music fan, so what was he going to do to earn a living? Space exploration for nuclear stations, NASA corruptors, rocket consultants, space exploration, excursion to stars, on a military mission, on a military ship to Mars. I see you in my stars.
The first solo project was intentionally lo-fi, rough, intimate, personal. The album was called Monkey Business and it had a great lead track.
There was a song there called My Star that I just thought was a top five single, and it was. And I'm not rewriting history, it just was, this is a classic Stone Roses dream. So what a great song. So therefore, I was actually not at all apprehensive, and this is going to be fun.
Monkey Business was released in 1997 to critical acclaim and was followed by Golden Greats in 1999.
The first record has great charm, so he sort of made it in his bedroom, great charm. The last record was a move forward musically, but a sort of hybrid.
Talent, attitude, I mean, where do you think Liam Gallagher got it from, and intelligence. What can stop Ian Brown? Nothing except perhaps the rep for bad behaviour. From the graffiti vandalism of the 80s to the paint bombing of his ex-record company's offices and Jaguar in Wolverhampton, all the way to 1998, allegations of air rage that brought him to this court.
The 35-year-old frontman for the Manchester group The Stone Roses denies using threatening behaviour on a flight from Paris to Manchester in February.
How long did you do in jail?
60 days. I had that feeling when I was in there, burning feeling of innocence, you know what I mean? I feel like this system now owes me 60 days. I've got to do everything in my power to take that back.
The new album, Music from the Spheres, is out anytime now. Again, moody, very intimate, Ian Brown on top form.
I think he's attained a sound that is extraordinary in the sense that it's... to me, it sounds like an 80s album, or a very, very good 80s album, but it sounds like the sort of music that the Stone Roses is trying to get away from. And he's gone full circle, in a sense. But he's done it in a very classy way.
It's interesting for Ian, because this is, you know, it's moving down further into his solo career, and And I think it would be great to see people's reactions to how things have changed. I think it's the way it's been moving, it's moved further, but it's even more experimental, I think, than it's been before.
The music hasn't actually changed. It's just gone a kind of different direction.
I think Ian Brown's a hard-working person. I think he always was. I think that got lost a little bit in the Roses sort of chaos. So I think he's more in control now, and being a solo artist seems to suit him.
But this is a solo artist who understands the utter importance of collaboration.
Because I took that much on my first two LPs, I need to concentrate on the melodies and the lyrics. It's best for my lyrics, must be much, much stronger. So I need someone to come in to help in the music to take that weight off. Dave was perfect.
Tell me about Dave.
Dave was a programmer when we first met, and we just clicked within about 3 hours. It's like I'd known him all my life.
As I started working with Ian, I didn't really know much about him. I knew Phil's Gold, like as everybody does, but I didn't really know anything about Stone Roses. And the first thing I actually really caught my ear was My Star. Well, for the last 7 months, I've been working on a new album with Ian. Worked all the way through the winter, worked really, really hard. Last one, we had 6 weeks to do it. I didn't know Ian, Ian didn't know me. It was bang, bang, bosh, bosh, but it was a vibe, you know what I mean? So we got it done in 6 weeks, and that was even writing a few tunes. But this one, we took our time.
We said, let's write some songs, but they've got to be proper songs, proper melodies, proper lyrics, but they've got to have a proper modern sound to them. They've got to be state-of-the-art sound. No, he took that on. He was working till 6 in the morning. He was back up at 9 o'clock. He was on it and on it and on it. So halfway through, I thought, well, we are co-producers, but he's put so much into it that my name's on the sleeve anyway. I don't need the thing. I make him the producer so he can get on in the game because he's got that talent.
Definitely.
Yes. To me, we're on it. It's smoking, Popper.
The tablets are really good in that, aren't they?
Brilliant.
We should have... I can't believe that we didn't even put that in the original, you know.
You love Manchester, don't you?
I love Manchester, man. Yeah, it's the true capital.
What are your feelings about Manchester today and what's been achieved?
I don't see that we've come any further than we were 10 years ago.
No.
I think now we're on the map and now people hate us more than they hate the Scousers. I think we're now the most hated, which has got to be some kind of achievement.
It has indeed, it has indeed. Your wife's Mexican, you make a living in Manchester.
Yeah. I couldn't make a live anywhere else, really. If I did live anywhere else, I'd live over in Mexico. But like she says, Mancunians are the best dressed, the coolest, and the smartest that she's seen in England.
You've taught her well.
She knows right.
She knows right. The next move for a man who moves better than most is control, sound control.
The production area is involving you more and more. Why is that?
I love the fact that you can layer things and you can create anything you want in that environment. £1 million worth of equipment, you've got the ability to literally do anything.
The fascination with sound has led you to what recently?
Well, in the past I've been offered a lot of remixes, but it's usual doof, house music. So the man at Sea Priest has sent me a CD.
He didn't want to do a remix. Normally a remix, you get a part stat, you sample a couple of loops of it, you stick your own beat behind it, you ship it back to the record company and you count the cash and have a good old laugh about it. Meanwhile, the record company put your name on the poster and use you as a marketing tool.
This is the manager who used to work for a record company.
That's exactly right.
You know, yeah. How it works.
So I know exactly how it works.
Email. Copy it in GridNote, so that I was highlighting the measure at the start.
Here's my notes. Here's my lyrics. James's lyrics. Nicky's lyrics.
It was an experiment for him to see how he could take someone else's music and visualise that music using, as I said before, the music in his head.
Can you get them stronger at the end?
Yeah.
Can you pad it, flat-hand it, or palm it instead of using your fingers? On hearing the voice, I thought, I can do a lot with that voice. I can bring my own guys in. So I brought some players in, give them a groove, they've got bass lines, they've got guitars that they've never had before. I put them a little rap on it, rock it in a van like a Manic Street Preacher, and I've given them a sound, and doing it has proved to me that I can do it. That I do understand music, and that I can get a good groove.
What to you does the producer do?
He is the whole thing. For me, on this last thing I did, I was conscious that the singing must be good. You must have good singing on a record, it just won't work. So I was conscious that, and also being a singer, I turn myself down usually. I always bring my voice down to bleed into the music, but on this I wanted the vocals right up there. So yeah, it's the whole thing is the record. You're making a record. It's hard mixing, it's worse than DJing. DJing's hard, you know.
Other ambitions that are left, you're going to do production. I think there will be more solo work as well.
I want to work with trumpets.
You want to what?
I want to work with trumpets. The way that you go to Mexico and their music with the trumpets is so powerful. The trumpets are the best. I've been in Morocco and up the back streets when they have the guy in the chair and he's got the feather and the big trumpets come behind. Trumpets are triumphant. And I want to work with trumpets, definitely.
Life in Lim. Family life.
Yeah.
You a family man?
Yeah. Ian Family Man Brown, definitely.
Has he matured? Has he become easier to deal with? Or was that never a question for you, Nigel?
I think as everybody gets older, they become different. Their priorities become alter. And so, yeah, I suppose he has. You know, I mean, he's 12 years older than when I first knew him. So if he hadn't changed in 12 years, it would be a serious problem, wouldn't it?
How many children?
Three sons.
Three sons?
I've not been trusted with a daughter yet.
Absolutely. What age?
Frankie's 9 and a half, Casey's nearly 6, Emilio's 16 months.
Do they have attitude?
Yeah. Serious attitude, yeah, they do. They're into Dre and Eminem. But if I put anything on guitars, you'll turn that off, that it's old. And they start laughing, they just roll around laughing at it. If I put the Beatles on, they just roll around laughing. It's just nothing to them.
At least 50% of the audience is young kids. And I find that a real testament to his enduring appeal.
I believe, I always believed in youth. I went to school with him.
Yeah. It's a...
Evelyn.
Evelyn.
How do you do, sir? Nice to meet you, boss. All right, boss.
Thanks.
Brilliant.
Thank you.
Coffee.
Excuse me. Camera. Yeah, no. Excuse me. He gets a beautiful girl after his daughter. I get a drunken tramp saying the old house. It's not right. It's not right. It's unfair. Oh, God.